Hi again, this is Chicho. Welcome to my channel. Now what we're going to do in this video is touch on a sort of a type of problem that comes your way starting off and basically in grade 9 or so, and then they make it more complicated every year. So it comes to you in grade 9, grade 10, and then the more complicated stuff comes in grade 11 and 12, okay? And that, you know, the category of that problem that people see, and people usually have a hard time with it initially until you see the pattern, right? And those problems are related to consecutive numbers, okay? And there's basically three different types of consecutive number questions that come your way. One of them at the beginning anyway, in grade 9 and grade 10, is generally it's just consecutive numbers, straight out consecutive numbers. The second type of problem that comes your way are even consecutive numbers, and the other one are odd consecutive numbers, right? So what we're gonna do is we're gonna take a look at all three formats, and we're gonna lay them out here so you see, you know, what the difference between all three of them are. And we're gonna do one question from each one, okay? Starting off with just straight up consecutive, which is the easiest ones to do. And then we're gonna, you know, in the third one, probably gonna hit up stuff that, you know, grade 11 can do. And sometimes you see this coming up in grade 12 with the more complicated stuff. If you have like three or four consecutive numbers in a row where you have to start doing some synthetic division, some of the stuff that we talked about in the language of mathematics towards the end of series 3b. So a lot of the things, at least two of these questions that we're going to do, you're going to need some of the material we covered for factoring polynomials, trinomials, and complex trinomials to a certain degree, okay? So basically, let's lay out what we're talking about here. And the type of question that this information is related to is the type of question that you would have seen if you're in grade 9, latest by grade 10, you see this, where they say, you know, the sum of two consecutive numbers is equal to a certain number, right? Or the product of two consecutive numbers is equal to this, right? So if you get questions where they're talking about consecutive numbers, this is the way you should think about it, right? In mathematics, when we don't know something, we have to sort of put a place marker for that unknown, right? And for us in general, we use the letter X. You know, X marks the spot, if you want to think about it that way, right? But X is basically your unknown, right? So if you're talking about two consecutive numbers, adding up, multiplying, you know, their reciprocal or whatever you want to do to them, right? If there's a problem coming to you with consecutive numbers and you don't know what those numbers are, the first thing you do is you call the first number X, right? Because that's your unknown, right? So we're going to use X, and the X represents a place marker, right? So the first type of question you end up getting are just consecutive numbers. And what we're going to do is we're going to actually just lay out all three of them first, and we're going to talk about how you set up the problems, and then we're going to do the problems. Okay, so we're not going to do the problems as we move from one, you know, consecutive to even to odd. We're going to lay out everything so you have a nice visual, nice understanding of what it is that we are talking about. Okay, so the first type of question we get are consecutive numbers, and this is the way you represent consecutive numbers. And if for those of you who are not sure what consecutive numbers are, consecutive numbers are basically numbers that follow each other, right? So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, those are consecutive numbers. 1,000, 1,001, 1,002, 1,003, those are consecutive numbers, right? So any numbers that are in sequence, in integers right now, that's what we're talking about, right? And in general, what we are specifically only going to talk about is integers, okay? So let's say you wanted to represent consecutive integer numbers, right? So how high up can I go? I can go all the way up here. That's good. So let's call this consecutive integers. Integers, okay? Now, the way you represent consecutive integers, as I mentioned, if you don't know what the first one is, just call it X, right? So if you don't know what the first number is, you're going to call it X. Now, if they're supposed to be consecutive, following each other, right? The next number in the sequence, what should it be, right? There's two directions you can go. You can go from, if they have to be consecutive, nothing says that they have to be consecutive going up. They could be consecutive going down, right? So what you could do for the next number to represent the next number, you can call it x plus 1, or you could call it x minus 1, right? So in general, I like working, representing the smallest number first and then working my way up. Okay. So what we're gonna do for the next number, we're gonna call it x plus 1. Okay. So for example, if our first number was 2, then the next number in sequence is going to be 2 plus 1, which is 3. The next number in sequence is going to be 2 plus 2 is 4. The next number in sequence is going to be 2 plus 3 is 5, and so on and so forth, right? So these are the first type of questions you end up getting. And the type of question we'll lay it out, but we'll solve it later. The type of question you get, they say, the sum of two consecutive numbers is equal to 15, right? So if you don't know what the first number is, you say, let x equal my first number, right? Because that's what it is. It's a place marker. We don't know what it is. And then we say let our second number is going to be x plus 1. X plus 1 equal the second number, right? And this let thing is called a let statement. And we talked a little bit about this in the language of mathematics when we're solving for quadratic equations, a little bit more complex quadratic equations, because what let statements do, they allow you to simplify things and to set problems, set questions up where you can actually visualize them and see how the thing flows, right? It's just a way for us to make things easier, right? So if you had, for example, two consecutive numbers adding up to be 15, all you would do, you would say x plus 1 is equal to 15, right? Let's do this one, actually, it's so simple. So what you do, you say x, that's the first number. Or if you want, here, we'll lay it out, set it up so visually you actually see what's going on. You would say the first number plus the second number has to equal 15, right? That's what we said. The first number plus the second number has to equal 15. Two consecutive integers have to add up to be 15. So our first number is x, right? Our second number is x plus 1. That has to equal 15. So 2x, x plus x is 2x. So 2x plus 1 is equal to 15. And then you bring the 1 over, subtract 1, and we talked about this. This video sort of kicks into the previous ASMR video we did when we talked about how to deal with an equal sign, right? How to move around an equal sign. That's essential. That's crucial. You have to know how to move around an equal sign before you can really do mathematics, right? You have to know your basic operations, addition, subtraction, multiplication, division, right? Exponents and radicals. But to really be able to do mathematics, you need to know how to move around an equal sign. That's a given, right? That's the essential. That's one of the first steps you need to learn. So this becomes 2x is equal to 14, and then you divide by 2, divide by 2. Hopefully we're not off the board. Oh, we're going off the board. So 2x divided by 2 is x, 14 divided by 2 is 7. So our first number ends up being 7. Or not our first number. Let's say x is equal to 7 because our first number might be something else, right? That's dark. Let's use rags to clean the board. My eraser is rough. So our first number, or our x, is going to be 14 divided by 2 is 7. Well, x happens to be our first number. Our second number is x plus 1. So 7 plus 1 is equal to 8. So our second number is 8, right? That's two consecutive numbers that add up to give you, where was it? Oh, add up to give you 15, right? So that's sort of a question that comes your way in grade, you know, 8, 9, right? Fairly simple consecutive word problem, consecutive integer word problem, right? Now, the second type of problem we end up getting is consecutive even integers, okay? So, dirty. I just ended up cleaning the whiteboard. So when I, you know, this is the first writing we're doing since cleaning it. So what's gonna happen? It's gonna look a little bit dirty after I give it a little white, because the contrast between having black on there and the white in the background is a lot, right? Now, the second type of problem we end up getting is consecutive even integers, right? And the type of questions you would get, same type of question, right? They would say, oh, the sum of two consecutive even integers is equal to 16. You know, what are those numbers? Actually, I'll say 14. Okay, what are those numbers? And, you know, we'll end up doing one after we lay out what it looks like for consecutive even and consecutive odd, right? And we'll reduce, you know, we'll wipe this off and set our table up there and do a couple more problems, okay? So think about it. Before I write down what the answer is, just ask yourself how you would go about representing consecutive even integers, right? Because consecutive numbers was easy. If we don't know what the first number is, we're just going to call it x, right? That's our place marker. Our second number after that would have been x plus 1, or it could have been x minus 1, right? But I like adding, right? Above this, I could have just put down x minus 1 and worked my way the other direction, right? Or just put x minus 1 here and work my way this way. The x was our place marker to represent the first number we didn't know. So how would you go about putting a place marker or representing an even number? Because if I just put down x could be anything, right? It could be odd as well. So I can't just put down x for consecutive even, right? So we're going to look for consecutive even. I can go up here. Let's call this consecutive even. Consecutive even integer, specifically. Okay. And let's turn this into a table. Okay. So we need to put in a place marker here to represent an even number. And we can't just put x. If we put x can be positive or negative. It can be odd or even, right? So x is not going to do it. And if we did put x, what would the next number be if they're consecutive even? And consecutive even is, well, they have to be even and they have to be in sequence, right? So 2, 4, 6, 8, those are consecutive even integers. Negative 2, negative 4, negative 6, negative 8. Those are consecutive even integers, right? Because integers could be positive or negative whole numbers, right? But if we just put an x and we say it's an integer, then it could be odd as well. So how do we make a number even? And this is a question that before I give the answer to anyone that I'm teaching this initially, I always pause, I ask them. So really answer this question to yourself. How do you represent an even number in a place marker, right? If you have to, in this box, right, in this unknown, how are you going to make sure that number is even, right? You got an answer? Now, the best way to make a number even is pair it up, right? X plus X, no matter what X is going to be even, right? How does that work? Well, if I write down x plus x, right? I'm guaranteed to have that as an even number. Agreed? Try it out. 1 is odd. 1 plus 1 is 2. That's even. 3 is odd. 3 plus 3 is 6. That's even. 4 is even. 4 plus 4 is 8. That's still even, right? So if you add a number to itself, it becomes even. The simpler way to do this, as we talked about in a lot of videos, instead of just writing add it together, you multiply it by 2, right? So the way you can write an even number is not just write down x, but 2x. So our first number is going to be 2x, right? Now keep this in mind that x is not our number, our first number. 2x is our first number. Okay, that's really important. People, you know, you'll see in the problems, when we end up solving these things, we end up solving for x, and a lot of people make the mistake of calling x the number. X is not the number. 2x is the number, right? So if 2x is our first consecutive even integer that we're looking for in some kind of problem that we're given, you know, two consecutive numbers multiply to equal something or add to equal something, then how would you represent the second number? Now, if you started off, let's say your first number was 4, to get to the next number, you either add 2 or subtract 2, right? So the next number in our sequence would be 2x. Instead of plus 1, it'd be plus 2, right? 2x plus 2. Or minus 2, but again, I like working up instead of working down, right? So if our first number is 2x, our next number is going to be 2x plus 2. The next number after that is going to be 2x plus another 2, which is 4. So it's going to be 2x plus 4. And then 2x plus 6, and so on, right? That's how you represent consecutive even integers. Your first number is 2x, your second number is 2x plus 2, 2x plus 4, 2x plus 6, and so on and so forth. On that mind frame, right, in that mindset, how would you represent consecutive odd integers, right? Consecutive odd integers. How do we represent consecutive odd integers? Ask yourself that. Do you have an answer? You can't just multiply it by 3, right? Because if you multiply by 3, sometimes it's going to be odd, sometimes it's going to be even. 1 times 3 is 3, that's odd. Okay, 2 times 3 is 6, that's even. So it turns out, I hope you've thought about it, I hope you've tried some answers, right? Because it's really important to think about problems and try to see how you can represent them mathematically instead of being given the solution, right? But the way to represent consecutive odd numbers, or the way to guarantee that a number is going to be odd, because in this box, in this location, we need to have an odd number. We have to guarantee for it to be odd. And we can't just put down x, because x, if it's an integer, then it could be odd or even. Again, just the same way the even was, right? So how do we make a number odd? The way we make a number odd, it turns out the easiest way to make a number odd is to make it even first, and then add 1, okay? So all we're gonna do is basically go, here, let me write it out the same way we did before. We can go x plus x, which is just 2x, and then add 1, right? Pair them up, add 1. Just think about it, right? If you're putting a group of people together, to guarantee that you have an odd number of people, pair everybody up and then bring one person in, right? Or take one person out, you're fired. So the best way to represent an odd number is to make it even first. Make it 2x. And then add 1. Or subtract 1 if you want. Right? For this one, actually, I do sometimes go in the other direction. If there's only one or two consecutive numbers I'm looking for, consecutive odd numbers I'm looking for, because the numbers are sort of smaller when you start dealing with them. Okay. But for now, just to be consistent, let's just work up. We're just going to keep on adding. So if our first number, remember, our first number is not going to be x. Our first number is 2x plus 1. So if our first number is 2x plus 1, what's our second number? Well, it's going to be 2x plus 3, right? We're going to add 2 more to this, right? Because if you're sitting in an odd number, let's say 7, to go to the next odd number in the sequence, right, is going to be, you have to add 2 from 7, next one is 9. So 7 plus 2 is 9, right? So every time in the steps, you're going to add 2. It's the same thing as here. Every time you go down, you're going to add 2. Over here, every time you go down, you're going to add 2. So our next number ends up being 2x plus 3, 2x plus 5, 2x plus 7, dot, 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 so on and so forth, right? Easy? Know this chart. If you're in grade 8, 9, 10, 11, and 12, these questions come to you throughout all of high school, right? If you're lucky, because they sort of give you an appreciation of how to deal with numbers, how to deal with problems, how to represent things mathematically, okay? Now, I say we're going to do all the problems in one shot, but we already did the problem for this, right? If you want, should we do another one for this? We could do another one for this. Let's do another one for this, okay? So let's represent these. I'm going to erase this and put them up top, and then we're going to do the let statement and solve them really quickly, condensed version, okay? So let's take this down. I need to upgrade my chalkboard. I think this thing's has, or my whiteboard, I think this thing's had its lifespan. So what we're going to do is we're going to transfer what we had in the table up here, condensed version, right? So consecutive even, or just consecutive numbers, right? Con. It was x, our first number, x plus 1, our second number, and so on, right? Consecutive even, con even, was 2x is our first number, right? Our second number is going to be 2x plus 2, and so on. Consecutive odd is 2x plus 1, 2x plus 3, and so on. Okay. So let's do one of these guys first. And we're going to lay it out properly. Okay. And then we're going to do it, and we're going to follow the same format for the next two. Okay. So let's say you had the following question. Let's say they gave you a question and said, the sum of two consecutive integers is equal to 35. What are those numbers? So first thing you do when you're solving a word problem like this, you end up using a let statement. I mentioned the let statements come into play in mathematics to simplify problems, to simplify equations for us, right? So what we're going to do, we're going to say let, right? We're going to say let x equal the first number, right? First number. Conversely, we could also write the sentence like this. Now just keep this in mind. I might switch up between the two formats, but you could also say let the first number equal x. Right? I could have just written it this way. Let first number number equal x, right? It's just like, as we talked about in the previous equation, when we're talking about the equal sign, one side equals the other side. It doesn't make a difference if I write it on this side or write it on this side, right? I could just flip the whole thing around, right? If this is equal to this, then this is equal to this. And reading it from left to right or right to left really doesn't make a difference, okay? So you have to know how to move around an equal sign. Crucial, 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 right? So we let the first number equal x. Our second number is going to be x plus 1. So let second number equal x plus 1. Okay. The problem again was this. Let the sum of two integers equal 35. What are those numbers? So if we let the first number equal x and we let the second number equal x plus 1, then the sum of two integers is equal to 35 means, two consecutive integers is equal to 35 means that the first number plus the second number has to equal 35. Well, our first number is x plus x and our second number is x plus 1, right? So their sum, if you add them up, has to equal 35. So the way you lay this out is you go x, or again, let's lay this out how your mind process should work. You would say the first number plus the second number has to equal 35, right? You just laid out the problem. Well, our first number is x plus x plus 1. That's our second number, has to equal 35. X plus x is 2x, plus 1 equals 35. Bring the 1 over, minus 1. 2x is equal to 34. Divide by 2, divide by 2. So x is equal to 17. Our first number is 17, right? What's our second number? Our second number is x plus 1. So our second number is 17 plus 1. So our first number ends up being 17. Our second number ends up being x, we're going to put there, 17 we're going to put here. 17 plus 1 is 18. And those are our two consecutive integers. 17 plus 18 is equal to 35. So we solve the first type of problem we get. And this problem comes to you in grade 8, 9, 10, depending on where you are. Let's do consecutive even problem. So consecutive even problem, let's make it a little bit more difficult. We're not just going to go to the sum of two consecutive even integers is equal to something, right? We could. It'd be easy. Let's say a problem, easy version of this question would be the sum of two consecutive even integers is equal to 14. What are those numbers? Well, let's do it. It'll be really quick, okay? So again, the problem is the sum of two consecutive even integers is equal to 14. What are those numbers? So what we're going to do, we're going to say let the first number equal, well, we know that the first number has to be equal to 2x. It's not x anymore, right? We set up the table, went through it. So the first number is 2x, okay? So let first number, I guess I should put number here, equal 2x. Then let the second number equal, it's going to be either 2x plus 2 or 2x minus 2, right? So if our first unknown even integer is 2x, the next number, because they have to be consecutive, you can either subtract 2 or add 2. We're going to add 2. So it's going to be 2x plus 2. So if the sum of two consecutive even integers is equal to 14, the first number plus the second number has to equal 14, then 2x plus 2x plus 2 has to equal 14. All right. That's our first number. That's our second number. Has to equal 14. So this is going to be 4x. And I'm going to bring the 2 over in one shot. Minus 2 has to equal 12. Right? Then you divide both sides by 4. Divide by 4. Divide by 4. So x is equal to 3. Okay. Now remember, x is not our number. 3 is not our number. It should be obvious because it's not even. We're looking for two consecutive even integers that add up to give us 14, right? So x is not our number. Keep this in mind when you're solving these types of problems. Our first number is, in the let statement, right? Our first number is 2x. So first number is going to be 2 times 3. We just substitute 3 in for x, right? Well, 2 times 3 is 6. Our second number is 2x plus 2, right? So it's going to be 2 times 3 plus 2. 2 times 3 is 6 plus 2 is 8. Our two consecutive even integers that add up to give us 14 is 8. 6 and 8, right? Those are two consecutive even integers. Let's do one consecutive even integer problem that's a little bit harder, okay? And you see this in grade 11 usually, and sometimes in grade 10. Okay. Let's say they ask you a question that's the following. The sum of the reciprocal of two consecutive even integers is 5 over 12. More difficult. Still using the concept of consecutive numbers, right? Something that's introduced in grade 8 and 9. But now they add a reciprocal to it. We're dealing with fractions. And the way to solve for this, the techniques you usually learn in grade 10, right? So by just adding one word, which is the reciprocal of two even consecutive numbers, right? It kicks up the difficulty level, right? So how would you do this? The sum of the reciprocal of two consecutive even numbers is 5 over 12. Okay. So first thing we do is, we do our let statement again. We say let the first number equal 2x, because it is, right? Let the second number equal 2x plus 2. Okay. Now, the sum of the reciprocal of two consecutive even integers is 5 over 12. Okay, let's lay it out. Reciprocal means flip it, right? So if our first number was 2x, the reciprocal of 2x is 1 over 2x. Okay? I might try to do this whole thing in one shot without skipping too many steps, but we'll see, right? So I'm going to adjust the thing over a little bit. That's our let statement, but equations I'm going to set up here, and maybe we can do a little bit of work here as well, okay? So again, the sum of the reciprocal of two consecutive even integers is 5 over 12, okay? So reciprocal means flip it. If our first even integer is 2x, then the flip of that, the reciprocal of that, is 1 over 2x. Okay. Hopefully that's good enough for you to see, right? Then it's the sum of the reciprocal of both numbers. So the reciprocal of the second number is going to be 1 over 2x plus 2. This has to equal 5 over 12. Okay. That's our equation. We just laid it out. The rest of this is just algebra. Until you get to the end, and then you have to go back to your let statement and plug the x in and figure out what your numbers are, right? But we've done the difficult part to a certain degree, right? Now we just got the grunt work to do, right? The sum of the reciprocal, 1/1/1, has to equal 5/12. So now we just have to solve this, and we talked about this in the previous equation, in the previous video where we were talking about the equal sign, right? How to solve equations. You multiply this by the common denominator, right? And the common denominator, now I'm going to make this a little bit easier because I'm going to factor out 2 out of this. So this guy is really 2x plus 1, right? Whenever you're trying to add rational functions and multiply rational functions and deal with rational functions, the best thing to do is factor everything first, right? Because we can see the commonality between each one. So I'm going to multiply this whole equation by, the common denominator is going to be 12 times I need an x and I need x plus 1. Right? And as you can tell, x and x plus 1 just comes in from that, right? But all we did was just factor out a 2. So if we multiply this whole equation by that, we end up getting 2 reduces 12 down to 6, x kills x. So this side becomes, or this term becomes 6 times x plus 1 plus 2 reduces 12 down to 6, x plus 1 kills x plus 1. So it's just 6x that multiplies that. So this becomes 6x is equal to 12 kills 12. So x plus 1, x times x plus 1 multiplies to 5. So this side becomes 5x times x plus 1. Now what we've got to do is we've got to crunch, right? Simplify the expression on this side. Simplify the expression on this side, right? Combine like terms if you can. Or if you know how to do this, you know your algebra well, you can do multiple steps in one shot, right? So first thing I do, I usually almost always get rid of my brackets first, right? So this is going to multiply in here, multiply in here, multiply in here, multiply in here. This becomes 6x plus 6 plus 6x is equal to 5x squared plus 5x. Now what I'm going to do, I'm going to, because we're short on space, I'm going to do multiple steps and, you know, multiple movements in one shot, in one step. That way we get our equation here. I'm going to factor it here and solve for it, okay? Hopefully we can fit it all in. But what I'm going to do is, this and this I'm going to bring over because I want my x squared to be positive, right? So 6x plus 6x is 12x. So this is going to be minus 12x. And I'm going to bring the 6 over and it becomes minus 6, right? So this side is 5x squared. 5 minus 12 is negative 7x. Minus 6 is equal to 0. Okay. And if you don't know, you know, you're having a hard time with this, you don't know this stuff, this is just combining like terms, solving equations. And we did a lot of this stuff in, you know, series 3A and 3B for the language of mathematics. I spent a couple of years going through these things. So I'm not going to go through all the little details because explain all the little steps because we've covered a lot of that. And it took 2 years to cover, right? So there is a lot of stuff that I can't cover in this single video, okay? But if you want to know how to do these, if you don't already, that's where you want to be. Now I'm going to make a little bit of room here. I'm going to erase this. But we already know how we got those, right? And we're going to factor this up here, okay? Now this is a complex trinomial. So what I got to do is get rid of the number in front of the x squared. Now I'm use the four-step method to solve this. If you've learned this, the odds are they, you know, in school they taught you decomposition, and I don't like decomposition. I like the method that I've shown before, which is the four-step method. So if you want to learn that method, know exactly what I'm doing. Take a look at that video. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to grab the 5, multiply it here. So this becomes x squared minus 7x minus 30. So this becomes x squared minus 7x minus 30 is equal to 0. And now I factor this just like a simple trinomial. Two numbers are multiplied to give me negative 30 and add to give me negative 7. That's negative 10 and 3. Right? So this becomes xx minus 10 plus 3. And then what do? In this method of solving complex trinomials, I take the 5 here and I drop it in front of the x's. So this step becomes 5 comes back in front, 5x minus 10, 5x plus 3 is equal to 0. Now in this factoring technique of this 4-step method where I factor complex trinomial, there's one other step that we need to do which takes us to the end with the thing, with the expression being fully factored, is once we reach this level and we drop the a term, the 5 term in front of the x's, from each term we take out a GCF and dump it. It's the only time really you dump the GCF, right? So over here between 5x and 10, the GCF is 5. So I take a 5 out of this expression and dump it, right? So this becomes x minus 2, and there is no GCF there, so it stays the same. So this becomes 5x plus 3 is equal to 0. Okay. Now, we've reached a level again. We talked a lot about this in series 3 and 3b, and we put together the video in ASMR math, which is the power of 0, right? This is the power of 0. This is what 0 allows us to do now, which is basically if we have two things or more things multiplied together to give us 0, then at least one of them has to be 0. And since we don't know which one is 0, what we do, we split them up and set each one equal to 0, right? We talked a lot about that in that video. Very important, very important, right? So what we can do now is just say, oh, x minus 2 has to equal 0. Equals 0, and 5x plus 3 has to equal 0, and then we just isolate x, just do algebra. So we have x is equal to 2, and x is equal to negative 3 over 5, right? Those are our x's, right? Now, doing this, in the original problem, the question was, the sum of the reciprocal of two consecutive even integers is equal to 5 over 12, right? So they have to be integers. Now, negative 3 over 5 is not an integer, it's a rational number, right? So once we reach this point, what we can do is just kill this one, right? Because it can't be that. It's not an integer. Negative 3 over 5 is not an integer. So the only possible answer is x is equal to 2, right? So we ended up getting x is equal to 2. Is that our number? Is that what we're looking for? That's x. So as soon as we end up solving a problem like this, we get to the end, we've solved for x, right? What we need to do is look back to our let statement and ask ourselves, what is it that we're trying to solve? What is it that we're trying to get the answer for? Are we just trying to find out what x is? No, we're trying to find out what these two, these two positive even consecutive integers are. So if x is equal to 2, then our first number was 2 times x. So it's going to be, our first number is going to be 2 times 2, which is 4. Okay. Our next number is 2 times 2. I don't know if I have enough room here. 2 times 2 is 4, plus 2 is 6, right? 6. So the two numbers, the two even consecutive integers that if we take the reciprocal of and add together to give us 5 over 12 are 4 and 6. Okay. that's a consecutive even word problem. Problem you would get in grade. You can get it in grade 10. I would give it in grade 10. Okay. Let's do a consecutive odd integer problem. And we're going to make it a little bit more difficult. Well, actually, no, it's not going to be more difficult. The adding and subtracting fractions is usually more difficult. And keep in mind, these problems just don't have to be two consecutive even integers, right? It could be 3, 4, 5. It could be a whole bunch of consecutive integers that add, multiply, divide, do whatever it is you want them to do to give you a certain result, right? And every time you add one more consecutive integer, well, on the next level, it would be much harder, right? If I had 3 consecutive even integers, the reciprocal of, that add to give me a certain something, then it would have been 1 over 2x plus 1 over 2x plus 2 plus 1 over 2x plus 4 equals something. And that becomes more difficult. Okay. That you're going to need synthetic division, something that you cover in grade 12, right? So as soon as you start getting into the reciprocal of 3 consecutive integers or 3 even or odd consecutive integers, you're sort of talking about grade 12 type of word problems, because you need synthetic division to be able to break down that polynomial, right? Again, stuff we talked about in series 3b, towards the end of it, we spent a fair bit of chunk because synthetic division takes a fair bit of work to do. Okay. Let's do consecutive odd word problem, and you'll see how things vary. Okay. So for the consecutive odd problem, let's assume we had the following question. Let's say they asked you, and instead of doing adding and subtracting, you could have done subtracting in the previous questions too, right? But instead of having adding and subtracting, let's talk about multiplication, right? What if they asked us to find the numbers if the sum, if the product of 2 consecutive odd integers was 63, right? So the problem would be the sum, the product of 2 consecutive odd integers is 63. So how would we lay this out? Okay. Well, we start off with our let statement again, right? So let the first number equal 2x plus 1. That's our first number, right? We've already laid it out. If we know the table, then these types of word problems become easier, right? So our first number is 2x plus 1. Let the second number equal 2x plus 3. Simple as that. The same way we did the previous two, or the previous three, I guess, because we did one. We cheated, we did one, actually four, I guess. But we did, I guess, 2 for this and 2 for this, right? We're only going to do 1 for the odd. So the product of 2 consecutive odd integers is 63, okay? Well, we got our first number. It's 2x plus 1. And our second number is 2x plus 3, right? Their product has to be equal to 63. So product means multiplication. So you just multiply them together and set them equal to 63, right? So 2x plus 1 times 2x plus 3 has to equal 63. Right? And again, series 3 and 3b, and you get these problems. This question could come to you in grade 10. Grade 10 or grade 11. Easy grade 11, hard grade 10, or normal grade 10. This question would be too easy for grade 12. Or it would just be a warm-up, right? So all we've got to do now is just foil this thing, right? And we've talked about foiling a lot. You should know how to do this. And just a heads up, the difficulty level of this goes up to grade 12 if we say the product of 3 consecutive odd integers is equal to a certain number. Because with the third one, all we would do, if there was 3 numbers, we'd add 2x plus 5, and all we'd do is just add these two, we'd have 2x plus 5 in there. All three of them multiply together to equal a number. Okay. But for now, all we've got to do is just FOIL this thing out, right? This multiplies this and this. This multiplies this and this. So 2x times 2x is going to be 4x squared. 2x times 3 is going to be 6x plus 2x plus 3 is equal to 63, right? And then I'm just going to combine like terms, move everything to one side because this is a quadratic. I have an x squared term and an x. I can't just separate them. I can just, isolate x on one side and set it equal to something. I need to be able to put everything to one side and factor, right? So we're going to combine everything. 2x plus 6x plus 2x is 8x. So this is going to be 4x squared plus 8x. And I'm going to bring the 63 over, minus 63, minus 63, not 3, minus 63 is equal to 0. Right? Oh, minus 60 is equal to 0, right? 3 minus 63 is 60. And then what we're going to do is, when we're trying to simplify, we're always looking to, looking for GCF, right? The GCF is really important, factoring technique to know, right? And we're going to notice, and we're always going to try to simplify, right? So we're going to notice that 4 divides into everything. So we're going to divide out the whole equation by 4. Right, just to kick it down a notch, right? So divide everything by 4, right? So this is going to be x squared plus 2x minus 15 is equal to 0. Okay. 4 kills 4. 4 goes into 8 twice. 4 goes into 60 15 times, right? Now what we do, we factor this like a simple trinomial. Two numbers are multiplied to give you negative 15, add to give you positive 2. Positive 5 and negative 3, right? So we break this down. X plus 5 minus 3. And now, again, we use the property of 0, right? The only way to multiply things together to give you 0 if at least one of them is equal to 0, so we can set each one equal to 0 because we don't know which one is 0, or they could all be 0, right? So we split this up. I'm going to do this here. Or do I have room to? No, I'm going to do it up here. So this is going to be x plus 5 is equal to 0, and x minus 3 is equal to 0. So this is going to be x is equal to negative 5, and this is going to be x is equal to 3. So I got two numbers, two x's as my solution so far for solving this quadratic, right? And they're both integers, so they both could be legit, right? And they are both legit. So what we need to do now is go back to our let statement and figure out what our two numbers are, because these aren't necessarily our numbers, right? Or sorry, where are we? These aren't necessarily our numbers, right? These are our numbers. These are just the x's. So what's our first number? So what we do is, because we got two different answers, there's two different groupings of numbers that's going to happen. What we're going to do is we're going to substitute negative 5 in for x first and find the grouping of those two numbers. And then we're going to substitute in 3 for the x and find those two numbers, right? And something neat's going to happen. So let's try negative 5 first. If it's negative 5, then all we do is we put an x is equal to negative 5 to find the first number. The first number is 2x plus 1. So our first number, should we erase this? Can we do it all here? Let's say we had it for this one. Let's do it all in here so we don't erase anything, right? If we're going to do it for this one, our first number is going to be 2x plus 1, which is going to be 2 times negative 5 plus 1, which is going to be, there, we'll do it here, which is going to be negative 10 plus 1, which is negative 9, right? That was our first number for x is equal to 5, negative 5. And what we're going to do, we've got to find the second number associated with x is equal to negative 5. So our second number is going to be 2 times negative 5 plus 3, right? Because that's our second number, which is going to be negative 10 plus 3, which is going to be negative 7. So our first two odd integers that multiply, consecutive integers that multiply together to give us 63, are negative 7 and negative 9, right? Negative 7 times negative 9 is 63. Okay? So that's our first group of numbers. Well, we're going to have to erase this. So let's erase this. Our first number is associated with x is equal to negative 5. So x is equal to negative 5 gives us negative 9 and negative 7. That's our first number and our second number. Okay. Now we have to find what those two numbers are when x is equal to 3. Well, if x is equal to 3, our first number is going to be 2x plus 1, which is going to be 2 times 3 plus 1. 2 times 3 is 7 plus 1 is 7. Our second number is going to be 2x plus 3. Right? 2 times 3 plus 3. 2 times 3 is 6 plus 3 is 9. So our second set of numbers is 7 and 9. Right? Which is neat. Because we didn't say they had to be positive odd integers. We just said they had to be integers. Consecutive, anyway. Odd integers. So the numbers could be negative 9 and negative 7, and 7 and 9, or 9 and 7. Okay. Those are the type of problems, in general, we get in high school regarding consecutive integers. Just straight up consecutive, even consecutive, odd consecutive. And you could get variations of this that could make it a lot harder, right? But this should give you a really good idea of how you set up these problems, which is really the main part, the hardest part of any word problem is setting it up. Okay. I hope that helped. That should allow you to deal with almost any type of consecutive integer word problem you end up getting. And keep in mind, always, not necessarily always, write out your let statement. For the easy ones, it should be obvious. But if you start getting hard problems, use let statements. And whenever you solve for x, when you get to the end, when you solve for x, right, always look back to your let statements and ask yourself what it is that you're trying to solve for. Were you just trying to solve for x, or are you going to use x to get your answer? And in this case, we're using x to get our answer again. I hope you enjoyed. I'll see you guys in the next video. Bye for now.